Hi, in this video I'm going to introduce you with some basic Linux commands, and if you want to become a hacker or if you want to get yourself familiarized with the Linux family, the operating systems which run on the Linux kernel, just like Kali Linux or Ubuntu or Fedora, then you must be aware of these Linux commands. And the power of Linux actually lies in its command line. So you must be aware of the command line. So basically what command line is, it's a text-based interface which gives you the ability to perform tasks which you normally do from your graphical interface. So basically it gives you the power to do any task which you even can't do from the so let's just begin. The first family of command is file commands, and there are few file commands which I'm going to elaborate you in this video. So let's just open up the terminal, and to open the terminal just click on this terminal icon, and this terminal introduce you with the bash interpreter. And what actually bash is, it's an interpreter which interprets these commands. For example, if I do ls, I'll get all the directories listing whatever be inside my home folder. So this command ls, it's get interpreted by an interpreter called bash, and bash is actually a default interpreter for most of the Linux based operating systems. There are other interpreters as well, but most likely you'll get bash interpreter. So the very first command is ls, and what it does is simply list the contents of the current directory. So if I open up okay, so I'm letting you see both the graphical interface as well as the command line interface. So if I do ls from the command line interface, I get a listing of directories, which is what we are seeing in the graphical interface as well. So if I want to go into this folder like desktop, I get this file. So if I do cd to desktop, and what this command cd is, it's an alias for change directory. And using this command we can change directories from one to another. So if I do cd desktop, now I'm inside this directory called desktop. And if I do ls here, I get this file which is here. So that's for the ls command. The next command is pwd, and what it does, it simply prints the current working directory. So if you see here, I'm inside the desktop. So if I just do pwd, I'll get my current working directory, which is home, my username Shiva, and then the directory desktop. So if I change to my home directory, now if I do pwd, it says I'm inside home Shiva. Alright, so the next command is cd, which I told you it is used for changing directories. And if I do cd desktop, I get into the folder desktop, and to get back to the previous folder, this one is used, cd dot dot forward slash. So if I do cd dot dot forward slash, I'll be inside the home folder. Now previously I was here, I get one folder back using this command cd dot dot slash. And if I want to again go to the directory Shiva, I can simply type in it. Now if I print the current working directory, we are inside home Shiva. Now the next commands are file manipulating commands, and these commands are used for manipulating the files. That means reading them, writing them, or changing the data inside the files. So the very first command is touch, and what it does, it simply creates a new file with the name supplied to it as an argument. So if I type in touch my file, it will create a text file called my file in the current working directory. So let's see, ls, I don't have any my file name of text file in this directory. Now if I type in touch my file, it will simply create one. Look at this, my file. And there is a switch in ls called l, and if I do ls hyphen l, it will list the directories plus some information regarding them, and this information include the file permissions, and I'll get back to it what file permissions are. And this is the owner of the file, this is the group to which file belongs, and this is the size, then the date last modified. So if we see this thing here, we see that it is last modified on 12 September 1956, which is the exactly same time, 1 minute ago. So we created this file 1 minute ago. Now here you see this zero indicates this file is empty and doesn't contain anything. Now that's a file. The next command is mkdir, and what this command does is creates a directory. So instead of creating a file, if we want to create a directory, we can use this command mkdir, and that will create the directory for us. So if we type in mkdir my directory, it'll create a directory here called my directory, as you see. And if we long list this thing, we get this my directory, and it is created on 12 September at 1958. Now the next command which we are going to cover is copy command, and cp, this is an alias for copy. So this is similar to the copy command which we use in Windows, and what it does is it copies the file, it will copy the file to some another file. So it takes two arguments. The first argument is the file which is to be copied, and the second argument is the file on which the file must be copied. So this is the source, this is the destination. That means if I use copy my file to my file 2, what it will simply do is copy this file my file to some another file called my file 2. So I just copied this my file to another file, my file 2. And what if we want to copy this my file to some other folder like desktop? So in this case, we just simply can pass the full path or the relative path as an argument. For example, to copy this file my file to desktop, I'll just simply make it like this. And what it will do is it will copy this file, my file, to desktop. And let's just list the desktop. And if we do the listing in this way, ls will list all the files inside the folder desktop instead of the current folder. So if we do this, we get this my file is copied to the desktop. So that's for the copy command. Next command is move, and move is what it's actually a bit similar to copy, but instead of copying the file, it actually moves the file from one place to another place. That means if we move the file, my file 2, to another file, my file 3, it will copy this file to my file 3, but it will also delete this file as well. So if we copy my file 2 to my file 3, it will copy this file to my file 3. But if we do the move operation, it will simply move this file into this file and deleting this file. So that's the difference between moving and copying. And there's a command called clear to clear the screen and make it look good. So if we move my file to my file 3, what it will do is it will simply copy this file, my file, to another file called my file 3, and then will delete this file, my file. So if we do the move to my file to my file 3, it simply deletes it and copies it to this file. The next command is deleting files, and in Linux family the command rm is used to delete the files. And this command rm, it refers to remove. So basically it's an alias for remove, rm. So the syntax is very simple. You just put in rm and then the file name which you want to delete. So if I want to delete my file 2, I can simply type in this and my file 2 is deleted. Similarly, I will delete this. Now you remember this directory which we created earlier in this video using the command mkdir, that stands for make directory, right? So what if we want to delete a directory rather than a file? So if we try to delete a directory using rm, we'll get an error saying, okay, it's not a file, it is a directory. So in this case, we can use a switch called r. And what this switch refers to is recursive. That means it will delete all files inside the folder, and when the folder is empty, it will delete the folder. So if we type in the command, previous command, this way, it will actually delete the directory. So if we see, there is no my directory here. So to delete the files, we can simply pass in the file name. But to delete the directory, we got to use some switches, and we got to use this R switch. Okay, so let's just clear the screen and move forward. Next commands are dealing with adding text to a file. Sorry for the interrupt. So the next commands are doing some stuff like adding text to a file. And the very first command is echo. And what echo does is it simply echoes back whatever we pass in to it as a argument. So if we do echo hi, it will simply print hi to the screen. And how can we use it to add text to a file? There are actually multiple ways of doing it with echo as well. So if I want to add some text like hi to some file me.txt, and if I use this symbol angular bracket, this symbol refers to redirect, and what it does is it creates this file me.txt and it will put in this thing hi into this. So if I type in this, I'll get a file here called me.txt, and if I see what is inside it, we'll see hi. And cat is a command which is used for concatenating two files, but in Linux it is mostly used to print the text inside a file. So you can thought of it as a type command in Windows. And okay, so if we does it this way, what it does is it executes this query first, and whatever this query returns, it will redirect this thing to the file, my file. So if we do echo text, it will simply echo text back to the terminal, and this text which is echoed back will be redirected to this file, my file. And there is another similar thing which is called append. So if we have the same file, if we do it append to the file, then what it does is, instead of creating this file and writing into the file whatever be the outcome of the previous command, it will simply append the data to the file. That means it will read this file, if it already exists, it will not overwrite it, but it will just append the data to the end of the file. That means if we cat, we have hi twice, and this is because we just appended data to it. And what is the difference? Let me clear you. If we do this redirect, then what it will do is it will open this file me.txt in write mode. That means whatever be the data inside the file me.txt is, it will be vanished. That means high five, and if we do it, we get the file me.txt. But now this file only contains this data high five, and the previous data which was high and high, it is now overwritten. So if we want to overwrite the data, we use redirect, and if we want to append data to the file, we use append. So high five again, and if we, instead of redirecting, append it, then we will have the previous data, this high five, as well as this high five again. So if we type in cat me.txt, we get this as well as this. So that's the difference between appending and writing. Now the next commands are man pages. And what a man page is, in Linux, man pages are very useful, and especially for newcomers, those who don't know how to operate the commands. And they give you usage description and options about a command. So man pages are So man pages are invoked by using the command man, and if we have some command like ls, which we don't know how to operate and for what purpose the command is used, we can simply look into the man page of the command, and when we click enter, we get everything about command. This is the ls command, and it is used for listing directory contents. The description is also there. This description also says it is used for listing the files, and there are all the switches available with the ls command. A command is used for listing all files. That means we sometimes have hidden files which starts with dot in Linux. So if we want to print every file, then we use this tag A, and we also have other tags as well, including this L tag, which we used in this video to demonstrate you the other file properties. So it is used for long listing. That means it instead of just printing the names of files, it also prints some additional data about it, which we saw. So let's say we have some command sdb, which we don't know what purpose it is used for. We can simply do man sdb, and it says no manual entry. So it might also be the case that you may not have the manual entry for a particular command. So in this case, you got to go to the internet, search for it, check their official documents to see what the command actually is and how it works. So if we do man clear, we have the info, it is used for cleaning terminal, and the description and the tags which are used, and so on. So this could be your best friend in learning command line. Now coming to user privileges. In Linux, we have some categories of users, and based on the category on which the user lies, we give them some privileges. In most of the Linux systems, root is the super user. That means there is a user called root, which is a default, and which controls the entire system. It has full access to everything, to every file. And in Kali Linux, we have a default user root, and this is the only root user present if you have done a fresh installation. You might also add users as well as delete users, give them privileges, but if you are operating Kali Linux, then you have only single user by default, and this user is root, and this user has all the privileges to do whatever it wants. And this is a recommendation that we should not operate our system with a user, with the root user, and this is because we may harm our computer, since the root user has full access, full privileges. There might be a case we could harm our operating system. So it is recommended to have other users and assign them privileges to run command with the root privileges. And this is done by adding them into a group called sudo. So in Ubuntu, you might have this group sudo as sudoers. So you got to see, in most of the systems there is a group, either it's sudo or it's sudoers. So if you want to add a user, just add the user, make it to the sudoers group, and then the user may be able to run even those commands which require full access or root privileges. Now coming to adding a user, there is a simple and clean way of doing it, and this is done by using this command called add user, and it is a really simple command. What you need to do is type in add user and the name of the user which you want to add. For example, I want to add a user called Kali Dojo. I'll simply type in, and it says only root may add a user or a group of the system. That means you got to have privileges for even adding the user. So this is why I got to use a command called sudo, and this command gives you the privileges to run commands which require root privileges. So if I type in Kali Dojo, now it will prompt me for the password. I just need to I just entered my password, and now it wants me to type in the password for the user Kali Dojo which I want to add. So I can type in any password and it won't show you on the screen. Then it asks me for further details. If you want, you can enter the details, else you can just click in enter, and that's it. Now the user Kali Dojo is added, and the very easy way to confirm whether the user exists or not is doing ls to home directory. So whenever in Kali a user is added, it creates a directory in the home directory for the particular user, and all the things which this user Kali Dojo will do will be stored inside this folder. So except if it doesn't use sudo. So now we have added a normal user or standard user Kali Dojo. So if I want to give it a sudo privileges, that means if I want this user to be able to run commands which require root privileges, I need to give it sudo privileges. So if I don't want, I may leave it as a standard user, and it might be able to perform regular tasks, but it won't be able to perform administrative level tasks. So in order to add the user to the sudoers group, we just need to type in a simple command add user, then the username, then sudo. That means the group name. So add user, then the username which is Kali Dojo, then the group which we want to assign it to. Okay, it says Kali Dojo is now the member of the group sudo. So in order to verify it, su is a command which is used for switching user. So if I switch user, if I switch user to Kali Dojo, now I'm Kali Dojo. As you can see here, Kali Dojo at Kali, that means I'm inside Kali Dojo. Now if I try to use sudo, I get this thing, sudo password for Kali Dojo, and when I print in the password, I get the directory listing. And if the user is not the part of the Kali sudoers group, it will simply give it a warning saying you can't, you are not a super user, you are not a part of sudoers and you can't use it, and this will be recorded. Again, su is a command for switching users, and to use this command you need to be having privileges. So if you are a root, you can simply use it as it is, but if you are not a root, you need privileges. That's why you need to use sudo for switching users. That means if I try to switch user to Shiva, although I entered my password correct, it says authentication failure, and this is because switching user is an administrative level task, and for this we need permissions, and that permission is only belonging to root user. That means in order to do this task we need root privileges, but we are not root, we are Kali Dojo. So how to do it? To do this, we need to use the sudo command, and if we are the group of sudo, we are able to do it. So now I am switched to user Shiva, and this is the double exclamation mark which is used to run the previous command. So this is just a shortcut for saying that I want to run the previous command. Now file permissions, as I told you, by using ls tag l we can have several other info other than the names of the files, and this info contains the file permissions and the date last modified and so on. So let me just clear it. So now what actually the file permissions are and how they work, let's just take this me.txt as an example. So I'll clear it so that you may have good idea. Okay, so we have this first octet R, W and dash. Then we have a second octet R dash dash. And then we have a third octet R dash dash. So basically we have three octets, and these three octets define file permissions for three different group of peoples. This first octet, this define permission for the owner of the file, and the owner of this file me.txt is this one. That means this is Shiva. So this Shiva, this is the owner of the file. This Shiva, this is the group to which the file belongs to, and in this case it is same, but it may not be the same. And this is same because I just created this file, so it belongs to me and it also belongs to the group Shiva, but it might not be the same. For example, it may belong to me, but it may be the part of root group or sudo group or any other group. So basically we have three sets, which links owner, group, and let's just try to understand it with example. In the example, the RW denotes file permissions for the owner of the file, which is Shiva in this case, and let me show you with this example. So in this case we have RW and dash. This defines the permission for the owner of the group, which is Shiva. That means if I am Shiva, I can read the file, I can write the file, but write permission, that means I can change the contents of the file, but I cannot execute it because of this dash. And we have three octets, R, W, X. R is for read, W is for write, and X is for execute. So I can read the file, write the file, but I cannot execute the file. And that's what this hyphen or tag denotes here. Next set of permission is R dash dash, and this is the permission for the group to which the file belongs to. And in this case, it is again Shiva. So if you are a part of this group Shiva, then you can read the file, but you cannot write or execute the file. So in this case, this file is a text file, so there is no way of executing it. But if it could be the executable file, then there might be the execute permission required as well. So depending upon type of file, different permissions are required. And this third octet, R dash dash, this defines the file permission for all other people. That means if you are not the owner of the file, and if you do not belong to the group to which the file belongs to, then this set of file permission defines what you are allowed and what you are not. So basically, everybody can read the file, but cannot write or execute. So this is what this R dash dash shows. Now coming to some, you have seen Leafpad and Gadget and Notepad. These are the graphical text editors for editing the file. But on the contrary, we have some command line based file editors as well, and Vim and Nano are the two which are quite famous. So if I want to use this file me.txt and open it with a command line based text editor, I can simply type in Nano and then the file name. And this is the interface which Nano brings to you. Now you can use the navigation keys to move up and down, left or right, and then add text whatever you want. Hi again. You can simply add in some text, or if you want, you can delete the text as well using backspace and the simple command. And if you want to write, you just press Ctrl plus X, and then it will ask you to save the file. Press in Y and press in the Enter, and here you go, your changes are saved. Now what if you want to do some common tasks like searching in the file? So this you can do using the command Ctrl plus W. Just nano the file, get into the Nano interface, type in Ctrl plus W. It will ask you for the keyword which you want to search. Here you just see it is asking for the keyword. I will simply say I want again, press Enter, and it brings the cursor to the first location where again appears. If you want to search it again, Ctrl W, Enter. And to close, type in Ctrl X and it will close. The next editor is VI, and what VI refers to is Vim. And this is one of the most advanced command line editor, and it is quite difficult to operate it, but it has a lot of advantages as well. So to open it, in you just need to type VI or Vim vi was the previous version, now it is vim. So you can type in vim or vi, whatever be, it will use vim. So if we type in vim, then the file name, it will open the file. And unlike nano, you can't simply just navigate and enter and edit whatever you want to. In vim, there are two modes which are called insert mode and command mode. In command mode, you can just navigate to the file. And by default, when you open a file with vim, you are into a command mode and you just can navigate to the file and do some commands which you want. By default, vi is in command mode. You cannot directly enter text. You can use I to switch to insert code. So I am here in command mode. If I type in I, now I am in insert mode, and this insert here, this indicates the thing. So now I can add whatever I want and can simply do it just like a text editor. Alright, now I have done my editing. To get back to the command mode, I got to press this key escape. Okay, now when I pressed escape, I'm again inside command mode. Now in command mode, we have some commands which are used to perform some tasks, and to launch a command we need to type in colon. So just type in colon, and now this cursor here, it is blinking, it is asking for the command which we want to execute. So if we want to save the file, we'll type wq, and it refers to write and quit. So what it will do is make the changes permanent and quit the vim editor. Now it's done, and to verify the changes are made, we can check the contents of the file. Here it is. Now there are some other commands in vim as well. In fact, there are so many, but I can't cover them all. The basic one is this wq and dd, and what dd is used, it is used for the for deleting the line. So if I again open it in, let's just say I want to delete this line, I just can simply pass the command dd and it will delete. Okay, in the new version it is only d, so if I pass in colon d, it will delete. And it might be dd as well, depending upon the version of vim you are using, and it is most likely to be dd. Now managing installed packages, we have a user friendly package manager in Linux called apt, which is also known as aptitude package manager, and this one is very popular in Debian based distros. And what it does is it simply allows you to install or remove packages very easily. All you need to do is simply type in apt-get install package name, and if you're using newer versions of Linux, you can use it in both ways, either apt then install and then the package name you want to install. For example, you want to install some package, just type in and it will install it. And but before you type in the command, you need to make sure that you have root privileges or you use sudo for this command, because apt package manager requires root privileges to run. That means you need to type in sudo if you are not a root user, else you can simply type in sudo apt install and then the package name you want to install. It will ask you for the password, and then it will try to read the file from the server and download it and locate it. But because this is not happening here, because this is not a valid package name, I just want to show you the syntax of the command. So if I type in Chromium, it will try and it will say that after installing, if I type in the valid package name, and this Chromium is a Chrome browser, and to install Chrome browser in Linux, you just need to type in this simple command, sudo apt install Chromium, and it will ask you that after this operation, this MB of additional space will be needed. You just simply can type in Y, and it will automatically install Chrome browser for you. But I'm not gonna do it for now. Another thing, in the newer versions you may use apt like this, but in the older versions you got to use it something like this. So instead of apt, you have to use apt-get for the older versions, and in the newer versions it will also work, but you can use it both way, either apt-get or apt. This is same for new versions of Debian Linux, but for older versions you need to make sure you use apt-get. In Kali Linux you have this file called sources.list, which is located under etc app sources.list, and what this file is, let me show you. So this file contains some links like this. So basically this is the repository which is maintained by Kali Linux, and this repository contains all the packages which Aptitude Package Manager tries to get and install it from there. So basically when we launch the apt command, it tries to get the package from this repository and pulls it to the local computer and then installs it. So you got to make sure you have latest repositories mentioned in this sources.list file, and you can refer to kali.org for the latest repository. You'll see the repository sources.list file. You just need to copy the contents of those repository files to this file to get latest packages available. Once you have repositories in your sources.list, you just need to type in apt-get update to update your package manager to get all the packages available from the repository, and it won't actually install all the packages, but it will just get information about all the available packages which are newly available from the repository. And once your Aptitude Package Manager is updated, if you want to update all your packages, you can simply run this command apt-get update to update all the available packages from the repository. So that's it for this video. I hope you like it. If there is anything you couldn't understood, please let me know, and I'll share this PDF with you as well. So thank you very much, and keep watching.